be with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another with the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amazing. That's a huge gift. I know those gifts that we get from our
so great, we can hardly even imagine somebody who loves us that much that they're willing to give their life for us so that we can live again after when we die from this earth. We can go live with it forever. Eternal life, what a gift. And all you have to do is to receive it, to believe, and to accept Jesus as our Savior. Now that we have a repeat after me prayer in, I'm going to let you all take this back to the back, and you can open it back there. There are a little presents inside of it that I want you to, when you use, when, because Lily is the biggest. And we're going to let Lily do it. And what you're going to find inside the in here is something that I want you to, every time you look at it, I want you to remember that Jesus came to die on the cross for us because he loved us so much that he was really ready to give us his life so that we could have this gift. Let us pray. Thank you, Father, for the greatest gift of all. Thank you for Jesus, who loved us so much that he paid the price for our sin to give us the gift of eternal life. In Jesus' name, we pray.
Because the world doesn't give us We come bringing the wants and desires of our own lives. Take us as we are, O God. And help us in these moments to be honest with you and ourselves. To know that your love expressed in Jesus Christ. Such a portion of your grace and blessing as will keep them and us under. put it to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read?" And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have answered right. Do this, and you will live." But the lawyer, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" And Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, Levi, when he came to the place and saw him, he too passed on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion, and went to him, and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, 'Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back.' Which of these 3 do you think proved neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers?" The lawyer said, "The one who showed mercy on him." And Jesus said, "Good, go and do likewise." Now as they, the group that was following Jesus, went on their way, he entered a village. And a woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teachings. But Martha was distracted with much serving. And she went to him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things. One thing is needful. Mary has chosen a good portion, which will not be taken away from her." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to you, God. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we ask just now that you would pour through me the gift of preaching, that these words might truly strike a chord within each of us, and that in this tumultuous time in the history of the world, may these words bring both comfort and challenge. To that end, O God, may these words truly be your living word to us. And we know they will be, for we pray with anticipation and joy in the strong and glorious name of Jesus, the Lord of our journey. Amen. One afternoon, about 12:30, I was returning from a hospital call when I came up this walkway and entered the auditorium here. And on the other side of that door, there was an elder standing there with 2 people that I didn't recognize. As I opened the door, he said to me, "Boy, do you preachers have a life about you. You work one day a week, and then once in a while you decide to show up here at the office, and then you show up at 12:30. You come in whenever you want to come in, and the rest of us have to, boy, that's the kind of job I wish I had." Let me tell you, for just a second, I wasn't feeling the love of Jesus Christ for that man. Now, I knew that he was only kidding, okay? I had that straight. But I wanted somehow to justify myself. So I began going through the day and all the things We both moved out from whatever else we were going to be doing for the rest of the afternoon. And as I was going up the stairs, I thought to myself, why did I do that? Why did I feel it necessary to try to justify my existence? And then it dawned on me, all I was trying to do was save face. That was really what I wanted to do. Anyone here ever done that? Anyone here ever tried to justify yourself? Anyone here ever tried to save face? Anyone here ever get into a big discussion with somebody over how wonderful you were and how hard you worked and what a gift you were to the universe? Well, there are two people in the gospel story this morning in Luke chapter 10 that did exactly that. They were trying to save face, and at the same time, they were trying to convince whomever how wonderful they were. In fact, we read there how that lawyer came up to Jesus and asked him, Master, teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life, to enter into life? What do I have to do? And Jesus responded, as Jesus often did, how do you read the law? And he said, you love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and you are to love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said, You answered rightly. And then you can almost see this lawyer sort of standing there with his chest out and his head back, saying, and who is my neighbor? Jesus does, as Jesus does so often, he tells a story. That's the way Jesus most often responds. He tells a story not about a Pharisee, not about a priest, not even about a Jew. Jesus tells the story of a Samaritan. Now we need to know that the Jews absolutely hated, they detested, they couldn't stand Samaritans. In fact, that hatred was so intense that they even thought of Samaritans as being somehow subhuman. And as for so many of our hatreds, this was kind of an illogical, ill-founded, untrue thing. But it was murderous to their soul. But that said, there was this enormous animosity between them. Could it be possible that Jesus was holding up one of these people to show, to exhibit the love of God? That lawyer, I'm here to tell you, was in for a rude awakening. The second person in our story this morning was Martha, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And that story of that little brother and sister group is one of the dearest, most intimate stories we have of Jesus. Because he could often go there to their home in Bethany when he was seeking to sort of regather his strength. Because there he could be himself. They allowed him a break from all the demands of people coming up and tugging on his sleeve, as it were, wanting something from Jesus. There were no demands. There was no pressure. We might think this morning of Martha as being one of those people who liked to be in control. She liked to have everything ordered. She liked to know where everything was. She had the name cards made. She had the vegetables chopped. She had the table set. She had the dishes out. She liked to be in control. She'd been chopping and cutting all morning, and now everything was perfect. Except when she looks out into the other room. Let me tell you that instead of stirring she was stirring up something else. There was a lot of bitterness out, a lot of anger in dear Martha, seeking to justify herself. She wants to tell Jesus how hard she's been working, and I'm sure she fully expected, not like a lawyer, for someone to pat on the back and say, "Martha, you're doing such a good job. You are so wonderful." She looks out and she says, "Jesus, doesn't it bother you just as bad that I've been out here working hard in this kitchen all morning? And Martha has been sitting, and Mary has been sitting there. Doesn't that seem a bit odd to you, Lord?" Martha's furious. And you can hear her. "Now, Lord, will you please tell Mary to get up off herself and get out here and help me in this kitchen? Lord, forgive me." And all the Southerners in this group. You see, Mary, Martha was from Southern Israel. This morning, Jesus wants to meet you and me and Martha and Mary and the Pharisees and Lazarus at our point of deepest need. I believe that there are three levels at which God wants to speak to us. And the first level is at the level of our stereotypes. Notice how I stereotype Southerners. It's easy to listen to do. I mean, it's one of the most natural things in all the world. We stereotype, I'm a preacher, and here people stereotype preachers, and they stereotype lawyers, and they stereotype doctors, and physicists, and school teachers, and all the rest. We do a lot of stereotyping in our lives and in our world. But in our scripture lesson this morning, Jesus goes beyond stereotypes and takes us to a new and deeper level of understanding. The stereotypes in first century Palestine, they stereotype Samaritans as being lazy and dirty and mongrels and infidels. They picked up all these stereotypes onto a group of people. And they felt like they were justified because who the Samaritans were, they were kind of half-breeds. They were Jews, but they had intermarried during the Assyrian captivity, and so they were viewed by Jews as these mongrels. Women in the first century Palestine were stereotyped. They were ignorant, they were chattel of their husbands, they belonged in the kitchen, they belonged taking care of their children. They were not to speak unless they were spoken to. They were to be isolated from the men. The men could be off in the living room talking to the Pharisees. They had to be separated out in the kitchen. And at one level, I suppose that's really where Martha is going, saying, "Lord, doesn't it bother you that Mary is not respectful of our norms or our taboos or the way of life we live? Doesn't that bother you?" Jesus is saying that maybe someone we would never, ever, ever have imagined may have a word from the Lord for us. And the thing is that we follow Jesus, Jesus forces us to move beyond, our stereotypes. The second level I believe that Jesus is addressing us today is at the level of our selfishness. What do I mean by that? I believe the reason why Jesus was a bit harsh maybe with Martha was that she was trying to care for Jesus the way she wanted to care for Jesus. Not caring for Jesus the way he needed to be cared for. See, Martha was in the kitchen and she was out there doing all this work, chopping and making him cakes and all of that stuff that was the way she wanted to do it, the way in which she was comfortable, was what she knew. It was what she did. But Jesus did it sometimes. The way we care for people is the way